Thank you. Yeah, it's a great pleasure and honor to participate this celebration. And yeah, my talk is about wild coverings of Berkovich curves. I do not assume good familiarity with Berkovich spaces, so I'll try somehow give some basics without giving too much details about Berkovich spaces. Okay, now. I see. Okay, now just. I see. Okay, thank you. So the goal size false will always work over in purely geometric situations. So we fix algebraically closed complete real valued field K, and we'll study Berkovich curves only over such a field. Now, a finite morphism of smooth K analytic Berkovich curves can be, in principle, you can also think about equivalent languages, but it's language of formal models or rigid curves. In the end, we all study more or less the same object from a little bit different angles. So it can be pretty complicated. I'll be able to draw some pictures in the middle of the lecture when I'll try to convince you that indeed they are not as simple, at least in the known tame case. And they may have huge, what I call topological ramification locus. All these notions will be introduced later. So one would like to give some sort of combinatorial description. For usual curves, semi-stable reduction actually gives a more or less best possible combinatorial description of curves. For morphisms, we'll see there is a sort of simultaneous semi-stable reduction. It does not describe the morphism good in non-tame case, so we want some fine information when semi-stable reduction gives. Main tools will be following two invariants of a function. First of them is what I call different function. Just at any point, it computes the different of complete residue field of that point over the complete residue field of its image. And there is a fine invariant, which instead of taking only different of such extension, takes into account a higher ramification theory. So this will be called profile function. Currently, I cannot explain what it is. Towards the end of the talk, we'll introduce it, and I'll formulate some results. Okay, so this is just the goals, and well, sources.
Also, is K algebraic of characteristic P?
No. The interesting case, in principle, can be any. If residue characteristic is zero, then it's not interesting because everything is tame, and but if it is P, both mixed and equal characteristic are equally interesting and will not distinguish them at all.
You haven't defined it, but these monomial bijections,
yes.
They're monomials in which, in what? In coordinates? Or?
Yeah, in coordinate of 0, 1, yeah. Just you have some function from 0, 1 to 0, 1, which is monomials of natural powers with some coefficients. Actually, coefficients will be from absolute value of k, but I don't formulate such precise. Okay. Now, sources, different function is studied in a joint work of my PhD student Adina Cohen and former postdoc Trushin. A separate paper was about profile function. Also, there is a short overview of two papers available now at archive. And these lectures also will be at IHES site, and also I posted at my site. So. Okay, now the plan. About half a lecture, I'll talk about more or less basic results, what is known to experts on Berkovich geometry, but again, I would like to recall various things. So first of all, we'll discuss Berkovich curves. Then we'll discuss morphisms of curves on what is more or less well-known. I cannot say classical because Berkovich introduced all this stuff in the 90s, so it's too early to say classical, but it's sort of classical for Berkovich geometry. And then we'll talk about different function and profile function on in the last two quarters of the lecture. Okay, so let's start with conventions. Probably I'll try to put some conventions here on board because the only problem with slides is that you know, I can put very few information simultaneously on the board, so I'll try to keep something. Evaluation always is taken real. I'll put in such a real evaluation. If it's not obviously otherwise, also we'll use notation k circle. This is the ring of integers. It's customary for rigid geometry and Berkovich geometry, and the residue field will be denoted by tilde. Okay, so this notation with respect to valued fields. Also we fix K, which is algebraically closed ground field, complete ground field.
And the evaluation is not trivial, or?
Evaluation can be trivial when all the results will be trivial. So it depends on you if you prefer to allow or not, but in principle it's okay. A k-analytic curve X will be called nice if it is smooth proper connected. In principle, one can, instead of smooth, only say Rig smooth and this boundary. For simplicity, I ignore this. In the papers, one considers slightly broader notion of nice. So for us, just smooth proper connected, and when it's just an analytification of some algebraic curve, which is also nice, it is smooth proper connected. Okay. And F will denote a morphism we want to study, so it is finite of nice curves. Okay, good. Now
go back one slide.
Yes. Yeah.
In particular, if x equals xn, is that what you mean to say?
What is if? In particular. In particular, it's a property of such a thing.
If it's an analytification, it's not always an analytification of an algebraic curve, is it?
It is always, under these assumptions, it is always. What in, it's written in particular, okay. It is the analytification. Yeah. About points of Berkovich space. So I don't want to give general definition, but maybe I assume a little bit that. You're familiar a little bit with rigid geometry. So Berkovich spaces are defined similarly. One takes affinoid algebras, defines some spectrum, which is richer when in rigid geometry, and when glues them, gluing is a little bit subtle, like in rigid geometry, so I want to skip the details, but it's important to mention that points correspond to semi-evaluations, to real semi-evaluations on affinoid algebras. And to any point, one can associate a completed residue field, a good invariant on point, unlike algebraic geometry, where points are just evaluated in fields. Here, they're evaluated in complete fields, so a really good invariant of point is completed residue field. So for a point x in x, we are given a h of x completed residue field.
So I think Berkovich considered more general affinoid algebras than intact, so there are the strict.
That's correct, but I decrease generality here from beginning, so we can assume everything is strict, and I'm not going to use this to any detail, so affinoid algebra will not appear in this talk. Okay, for any k variety, so in principle, since in our generality everything is algebraizable, we can only think about analytifications of some stuff, and it's maybe a slightly simpler way. For any algebraic k-variety, Berkovich functorally defines analytification and the map from analytification x to variety curl x. A fiber of a point z consists just of all real valuations on the residue field of z. And for any such valuation, we can complete k of z with respect to this valuation, and we get completed residue field of a point. So, in particular, for any closed point, since k is algebraically closed by assumptions, residue field is just k, so we can put only one valuation compatible with valuation of k, so the fiber is just a single point, and this is a classical point appearing in rigid geometry, so we'll call it a rigid point usually. In particular, if X, curly X, is an algebraic integral K-curve, when said theoretically, curve and ramification of curly X consists of classical rigid points, and everything else are just valuations on K of curly X, on field of rational functions. Okay. Now, points of K-analytic curves. Okay, so in principle, points are divided to four classes. This is more or less necessary for... let's try to do some order with this. So, type 1 are just usual rigid points, which are, sort of classical ones. Everything else should correspond to non-trivial extension. H of X over K is a non-trivial extension, so when we are given a non-trivial extension of valued fields, we can ask what extends. If a residue field extends, or if group of values extends. So type 2 is the case when residue field extends. So H of X tilde is strictly larger than K tilde, and it turns out it requires an argument, but it's not complicated. In this case, group of values is just the same as group of values of K. I am using that K is algebraically closed in this claim, and the residue field, complete residue field of X, actually is function field of a K-curve, so it's transcendence degree 1, and it's finitely generated over K tilde. So we'll denote this curve C of X. So X type 2, when C of X is the residue curve of H of X tilde over K tilde. Okay. Now, type 3 is the case when the group of values extends. In such case, one can show that the extension of residue fields is trivial, and the factor of groups of values is just z. Fourth case is when we have a non-trivial extension, but nothing extends. Neither group of values nor residue field. This is the worst case. It's called type 4. Now, a small remark. Fortunately, for us, type 4 points will not be essential at all, so I'll mainly ignore them throughout this talk. The real headache when one tries to prove stable reduction theorem or resolution in high dimensions. Stable reduction in high dimensions, this is really your enemy. But once we have stable reduction for curves, we are not in real trouble. Okay, now a fine line. So let's consider example how these points look like for an affine line. So take X is the affine line over K and fix a coordinate T. Then it turns out that any point of type 1, 2, or 3 admits a very simple description, just the norm corresponding to this X, the semi-evaluation, can be, when we shift coordinate by A, is just a sort of monomial evaluation. It's defined as maximum on monomials. So it's a sort of generalization of classical Gauss evaluation. When R equal to 1 and A equal to 0, it's Gauss evaluation. In particular, if X is of type 1, this happens if and only if R is 0, so this is just a classical point T equal to something. And otherwise, X is the maximal point which satisfies the inequality absolute value of T minus A is less or equal R. Because obviously any point which satisfies this should also satisfy less or equal in that equality. So X is the maximal point of a subset given by absolute value of T minus A less or equal R, so it's just a disk. So any such X is maximal point of a disk. So points of types 1, 2, 3 are just classical points and maximal points of disk.
What do you mean maximal point?
The semi-evaluation it defines on polynomials in T is larger or equal than semi-evaluation of any other point contained in the disk. Now we can parameterize point by A and R, so the question is what is the redundancy of such parameterization? It turns out redundancy is very simple. The disks must coincide for points to coincide. So non-Archimedean disks coincide if and only if the radius is the same, R equal S, and A and B are close enough. Yeah, any point is center of the disk, so this is. And because of this, we can draw a picture of X very easily. For example, for any point A, we have a line of points PAR. For any other point B, we have a line of points PBR, and they meet precisely at the radius absolute value of A minus absolute value of B. So the whole structure of type points of type 1, 2, 3 is just a sort of tree, which probably, even if you have not studied Berkovich geometry, maybe the picture of tree you saw, because it's very easy to draw, so in many reviews you just see such a tree. Now, a small remark, not important for us, type 4 points correspond to embedded sequences of disks without intersection, classical intersection. With no, so it may happen that we are given some intersection of disks without anything, and when it is type 4 point, I put it in the brackets, it's not important, so it's just... okay. Now, skeletons. Let's say that the subgraph gamma of x, by a subgraph we mean the following. It's a connected subgraph whose vertices are only of types 1 and 2. Maybe on this picture I should also explain you what are the types. So all these points are type 1, yeah? And type 2, 3, so the intersection points, they're type 2, the interesting points, are disks of rational radius, radii. These are points where we can specialize to different points, to different directions. And something like this is a type 3. So we want vertices of the graph to be only type 1 and type 2. And such a graph is called a skeleton if the complement of the set of vertices is a disjoint union of open disks and open annuli. Or maybe semi-annuli. By semi-annulus I mean disk, open disk, with a punch. So disk minus a point. Because my vertices can be at type 1 points, I also allow such a creature. So a typical example, take something here, make a cut, and make a cut here. What you have between two cuts will be an open annulus.
Can you also join 0 at infinity and P1 through all the gamma?
No, okay, I'm trying to keep a little... No, you want at least one type 2 point. You're absolutely correct. Okay, I try to... You want one type 2 point. Okay. Any skeleton gives a good combinatorial approximation of x because of the following fact. First of all, x without whole gamma, yeah, so for any annulus, we have a central chord, like here, which connects the two infinite directions of the annulus. So if we remove a central chord from the annulus, we get disjoint union of disks. So, fact is that, I did not spell out, it's written, but I did not spell out. We want the vertices to be, as I explained, and we want edges to be central chords of the semi-annuli. So if we remove the whole graph, the whole skeleton from X, we just get the joint union of open disks. So curve becomes extremely simple without the skeleton, and it indicates the skeleton knows almost everything about the curve, at least any combinatorial information. Any larger subgraph, any larger guy which satisfies these conditions also is a skeleton. Also, it's extremely useful property, holding only for curves. It's just low-dimensional phenomenon. And one can compute, for example, genus of X as the sum of genus of all points plus the first Betti number of X, or one can only sum over vertices of the graph and add the first Betti number of the graph. It means that the graph contains all points of X with non-zero genus, and the graph contains all loops of the curve. So graph knows a lot about the curves. It follows immediately from this observation that X without gamma is disjoint union of open disk. Now, by a genus of a point of a curve, I mean the following. If point is of type different from 2, when genus is 0, just we cannot assign anything interesting. But if it is of type 2, then we associate it to X a curve, Cx over residue field, and we can take genus of this curve.
What do you mean by H1 of X? Which kind of cohomology is it?
H1, you can take usual with integral.
Berkovich space.
Yes.
So as a usual topological space.
Yes, as usual topological space. Yeah. In fact, I don't need it, but it's usual topological space. Okay. Now semistable reduction theorem asserts that any nice curve possesses a skeleton. Okay. Probably this is not the formulation you are used to, but it's equivalent. And this is so-called skeletal formulation of semi-stable reduction theorem. We do not really need its relation to formal covers, so to formal models. I'll just briefly indicate it. So classical formulation is equivalent to the skeletal one, and it claims that X possesses a semi-stable formal model of a formal spectrum of K-naught, or since we are even in algebraic situation, even of a spec of K-naught, we can take algebraic model. And the relation between two formulations is as follows. We always have a reduction or specialization map from X to a closed fiber of a formal model. And then preimage of generic points of closed fiber of any generic point is just a single point of type 2. Preimage of a node is an open annulus, and preimage of a smooth point is an open disk. So actually, if you are given a semi-stable reduction, you can construct a skeleton, and moreover, you can naturally embed the incidence graph of the closed fiber of semi-stable model into Berkovich space. And the set of vertices will be precisely parametrized by irreducible components of the closed fiber. Okay, now local structure of nice curves. Actually, it can be obtained from stable reduction, but one can also go in other direction. One can prove by direct analytic techniques local description, and then it's not so difficult to glue it and to prove a stable reduction by purely analytic methods. So first of all, nice curve is a huge graph. Yeah, it's something like this, maybe with finitely many loops, but okay, we should think about it as a sort of graph. Yeah, by the way, I did not discuss the question, what is the topology? Again, it's not so important. For intuition, I think it's enough. There is some fancy topology, but let's ignore it. Any type 1 or type 4 point lies in an open disk. Because on the skeleton, we can only get type 1 at vertices, or we can have only types 2 and 3. Any y of type 3 lies in an open annulus. And description of type 2 points is a little bit more fancy, so it turns out that any point of type 2 has many directions, and these are parametrized by points of the residue curve of Y. So in the picture I placed here, every ramification looks like P1 over residue field, because all genuses here are zero. But in general, points can be of type 2 can be more complicated, and they do not have to be locally embeddable into P1. So there might be finitely many points which contain some genus, and okay. Well, now one more basic fact about curve. So any curve possesses a canonical minimal metric, so that logarithms of absolute values of functions are piecewise linear with integral slopes. So under this condition, there is a minimal single minimal metric. Its existence can be proved by few methods. You can use stable reduction, and you can avoid using it. So it's not as difficult as stable reduction. Now, I will prefer to work with exponential metric or radius metric. So radius of an interval is actually as exponential of the metric, of the length of interval with respect to metric. The advantage is that when absolute values of functions will be piecewise monomial, as we should think about them. So there is some dominant on any subinterval, on some subintervals there are dominant monomials, and we, so in a sense we avoid playing with logarithms, going back and forth with logarithms if we use radius exponential metric.
But how can this be, let us say, for the curve? So there are some cases where the semi-stable reduction is not unique, the minimal one, like for P1.
Yes.
So if you want to...
I never said anything about... Okay, but let's see P1. Yeah, this is actually P1. So here is the metric. The distance between points with the same center of radii S and T is just S over T or T over S, depending which one is larger than one. So it does not depend on any choice. Given a skeleton, gamma inside Y, we denote by R gamma the inverse exponential distance from gamma. This will be important in the last part of the talk. So maybe I'll put it here. So if we are given gamma inside Y a skeleton, then R gamma is the distance from gamma. So actually it means equivalently we can remove gamma from Y when everything breaks to disks. We can normalize them to be unit disk, and then the distance, inverse exponential distance from point Y to the skeleton is just the radius of Y inside the disk normalized to be of. So the same normalization I think was used by Francesco in his work on solutions of differential, periodic differential equations. Okay, good. Now, so far, this is the picture with curves. Now let's discuss morphisms. So first of all, I would like to introduce a multiplicity function of a morphism. Yeah, f from y to x is a morphism. So maybe I'll put it here, and f from y to natural numbers. So for type 1 points, multiplicity is just usual ramification index. For other points, the maximal ideal is trivial, but the field is not a residue field, complete residue field is not algebraically closed, it can extend, so the degree of this extension is multiplicity of mapped y. It's a very simple fact that f is a local isomorphism at y if and only if the multiplicity is 1. So actually, it's an interesting question, for example, to describe the set where f is not a local isomorphism. I'll call such set Okay, let me first say about this. I'll call such set topological ramification locus. So we consider multiplicity loci of f to be all points where multiplicity is at least d. This will be denoted nf. Huh? No, it depends. At some stage it will be, at some, but a priori you don't have to. So, all y such that nf of y is larger equal d. Okay. So one of our aims is to describe this. Also, we'll say that f is topologically tame if multiplicity is invertible in residue field. Okay, now fact, for any interval inside y, if we consider it parameterized with radius, with radii parameterization, when, first of all, the image of I under f is a graph, So I and this graph, we have natural red exponential metric, and with respect to this metric, the restriction of f is a piecewise monomial map, and the degrees of this map or slopes, strictly speaking, one has to say degree, but I'll say slope. In the sequel, these are just multiplicities. So if we know function nf on y, actually we know everything about metric structure of the map. We know completely what are the slopes of. So we completely describe the all metric aspects of. Okay. Now simultaneous semistable reduction. So a skeleton of f is a pair of skeletons on y and on x, so such the skeleton on y is preimage of skeleton on x, and the vertices of skeleton on y contain, the set contains the ramification locus. So in fact, the only reason why I insist to allow vertices of type 1 is that I want ramification points to be inside the skeleton. Okay. Now, theorem, any finite morphism between nice curves possesses a skeleton. This is so-called simultaneous semistable reduction. It's not stronger than Eugen's semistable reduction. Why? Because we know that once you can find one skeleton, you can find as many as you want, just enlarge, and you still get skeleton. So you can easily play with x and y and find a pair which is compatible. So the theorem is not essentially strong. It can be deduced relatively easily. The price we will pay is that it does not give such a good description of morphisms as semistable reduction provides for curves. Okay, so this is this argument that how to prove, deduce this theorem from stable reduction. And one can also formulate it in language of formal models. We'll not need it, so it's just a side remark. It's more or less equivalent to existence of a finite formal model. Okay, with both y, curly y and curly x semistable. Now, to which extent simultaneous skeleton trivializes a morphism? Okay, the answer is written here. On the complement of skeleton, our morphism is a disjoint union of finite ital covers of disks by disks. But such covers can be complicated. That's all the story. So they can be really complicated. Now, when
yeah. So here you exclude the characteristic P radical maps because you want ramification locus to be contained.
Yes. In this theorem, yes. In the end, in radialization theorems, we'll allow. But okay, I agree with you. But okay, let's ignore this point. It's minor. You can always split to purely radical and okay. Description of tame morphism. So any topologically tame, that is a morphism which is topologically tame at any point, ital cover of a disk by a disk actually is trivial. So just disjoint union of disks. So also for annuli, any topologically tame ital cover of an annulus by annulus is Coomer, so it's given by a simple formula, and it follows that if f is topologically tame, then the morphism splits outside of the skeleton. Any action can be only on the skeleton, and it's constant along any edge. On any edge, we have just the same power E, the same Coomer map, because any edge is just a skeleton of an annulus. So this gives very good description of combinatorial description of tame ital covers. So in particular, actually, what we get a map of graphs with multiplicities. And it satisfies natural conditions. I'll run through first two because they're really obvious. You have some local constancy of multiplicities. So let me not comment on these two, but just sort of very obvious. A little bit more subtle condition is that we also have a local Riemann-Hurwitz condition for this map of graphs. So we are given a map of graphs, probably. Okay, maybe I'll start here. Map of graph gamma y to gamma x. I know something like this. For a vertex here and its image, we can relate the genus of v and genus of u using the ramification along They are just by usual local Riemann Hurwitz, and not surprisingly, this thing follows from Riemann Hurwitz formula for reduction curves. So it's not stronger than usual Riemann Hurwitz. And okay, and in fact, these three conditions were the only numerical conditions the map of graph should satisfy. There are lifting results that if you give a morphism of graph which satisfies this, that, and that, then you can lift it to be a skeleton of a morphism of Berkovich curves. Okay. Now problems with the wild case. Okay, as I said, the tile cover of a disk by a disk can be complicated. Second, the extension of residue fields can be purely inseparable. If it's purely inseparable, we can say nothing interesting about the map of reduction curves, so Riemann-Hurwitz just completely breaks down. Third, even if it is separable, the local terms of E is now larger than E and E minus 1, and it involves different in general. So in case of wild ramification, even if the extension is separable, we have a trouble if... Okay, and two more examples. The non-splitting set can be huge. For example, and here I would like to draw a couple of pictures. For example, let's consider a map T goes to T to the P over, let's say, CL. It's CP over there, but let me take here just general L. And then maps looks something like this. And it turns out that there is a metric neighborhood of the chord 0 infinity where the map is not split, and it splits outside. So this size is absolute value. Okay, let me write it. Just immediately. Now it turns out that this radius R equal to 1 if L is not P, if we are in tame case, but it is a number which is equal to absolute value of P to 1 over P minus 1 if L equal to P. Both facts can be explained very easily. You should consider radius of convergence of P's root of 1 plus t. This is 1 if L different from p, and this is absolute value of p to p over p minus 1 if it is if L equals to p. So just you try to solve this equation in h of x, and you cannot solve in this radius, but you can solve when you are outside. We see that in general, the non-splitting set in non-tame case, it can be a huge chunk of a graph. Okay, and the situation becomes even more complicated if we consider, for example, C2. A mixed characteristic 0,2, and we consider a double cover of P1. Yeah, F lambda from E to P1 over K. In such case, we have four interesting points, infinity lambda 0,1. It turns out that if absolute value of lambda is large, if it is larger than 1, absolute value of 1 over 16, the number which is written here becomes absolute value of 2 squared, yeah, in our case. So if this thing of absolute radius, exponential radius 1 fourth, does not touch this locus, then the situation is relatively simple. We know that we have two disjoint parts. Here we can extract root of t minus lambda. Here we cannot extract root of t minus 1. Everything else is split. And okay, maybe. And above this interval, which connects the two non-splitting regions, we have preimage. We have two preimages. So what we get, here we have something like what I draw. So what we get is a bad reduction, curve, and one can even compute the length of the loop in terms of absolute value of lambda. So this happens if absolute value of lambda is larger than 1 over absolute value of 16. But if, okay, I don't have time to explain what happens if we are on the border, but it's easy to see, okay, let's see. If these two guys touch, if just they meet at a point, then instead of this, you'll just get one point, which is ordinary reduction point. Now, but the interesting thing is when absolute value of lambda is less than 1 over 16. This is equivalent to the fact that absolute value of j is less than 1, because there is scaling factor between j and lambda. And this is equivalent to j tilde equals 0, that is the curve, reduction curve is supersingular, supersingular reduction. And in this case, just by hands, one can compute the following situation, lambda infinity 0, 1. There is still the same locus around 0 infinity, the same locus around 0, 1, but at the touch point, there is, first of all, there is some direction, I think something like square root of lambda, in direction of square root of lambda, maybe. Not completely certain, where you'll get a supersingular reduction point. So this point has genus equal 1 and supersingular reduction. And this distance, or distance from this point to the two axes, is smaller than absolute value of 4. So this point is located much closer than you would expect. You have meeting of two things, and suddenly they cancel one another. OK, so this picture is definitely a little bit strange when you see it for the first time. Now I'll try to explain where it comes from and give some logic to. Okay. So the different. Okay, just motivation. These last two remarks, actually, especially the last one, says that different might be an interesting invariant to look at, and especially because different measures the wildness of extensions. If residue field extension is inseparable, we have wild extension, so it's natural to check how wild it is. Okay, and so we'll look at different. Now the definition which I'll use in this talk is the different of separable algebraic extension is absolute value of annihilator of omega of integers of L over integers of K. And before Offer says that this is incorrect definition, let me make two remarks. So first of all, we use multiplicative language. Yeah, small remark. So usual different will be a minus logarithm of what is written here, like exponential distance instead of distance. So we use multiplicative language. And important remark is that this definition is the right one only because in our situation, omega L naught over K naught is of almost rank 1. It's a subquotient of L naught. So in general, you should use a smarter definition which involves fitting ideals or something like that. So it can be, it's doable, but it's more. I prefer a simple definition for the talk because one just proves by hand, since we are a sort of one-dimensional situation, we are only studying curves of algebraically closed field. In our case, one can show that this module is a subquotient of L naught. So this definition works. Okay, also one can consider log different. It's defined similarly, but using logarithmic differentials. If k is discretely valued, when these two are related by uniformizers, and in general there are no uniformizers and we are just equal. So classical Riemann-Hurwitz formula for a morphism of algebraic curves is written using difference, so I just put it here, but it's in Robin's book, and you know, it's very classical. Okay. And now the different function. So now naturally we'll denote by y hyperbolic the set of points of types 2, 3, and if you wish 4, but again 4 is not important for us. And to a generically tile f from y to x, we assign different function, that is to any point y we just assign different of hy over h of f of y. Now, small remark, side remark. We work with not discrete valuations, yeah, unless we consider trivial valued case, which is not interesting. Otherwise, valuations are not discretely valued, and then there is no difference between different and logarithmic different. In fact, what I define behaves better if you interpret it as a logarithmic function, but we do not have to distinguish because just they coincide, but maybe. Okay. Now this guy measures wildness of f. In particular, is just constantly equal to one in topologically tame case, and it easily explains all phenomena we saw so far. I want first of all to give you intuition why this is helpful. Afterward, I'll formulate stuff like that. Okay. So first of all, here. It turns out that different in mixed characteristic, the difference is always larger equal than absolute value of p for extension of degree p. So there is a minimum, and this minimum is achieved on the very bad locus, on the curve which connects the two ramification points. It's very natural, and the different we measure different on y. So this is y to x. So here, and also, so this is absolute value of p, and it decreases. It increases in all directions with constant slope p minus 1, or degree p minus 1. It's a monomial function of constant degree. So on the distance absolute value of p to 1 over p minus 1, the difference becomes 1. And this is precisely the boundary of the wild ramification locus. When difference reaches 1, wild ramification stops. So it completely explains what goes on here, and it turns out that here also one can describe the picture a little bit more funny way. Again, it's absolute value of p here and here, so just slope 0. It goes with slope 1 in all directions outside of here, so it goes here and here with slope 1, but from here you have slope 3. And this leads to the supersingular point where you have a more ramified stuff. Everywhere else, you have just slope 1, so you can, from this picture, you can completely describe the wild ramification locus. It will not be a metric neighborhood now, because difference is changing, but it will be sort of conic neighborhood. Okay. Now, general facts. So, theorem. First of all, it's piecewise monomial on intervals. Probably this is due to Littke-Bommert. We proved also for type 4, we improved a little bit. The idea of proving of this is very simple. On intervals, we can divide interval to pieces which are embeddable in annuli, and map between annuli, you just write down a series and you compute and you see. It extends to a piecewise monomial function. That is, on any interval, it behaves like a piecewise monomial function. Yeah, also to type 1 points. And one can describe the limit behavior at type 1 points. So it turns out that it becomes constant if you have tame ramification. For example, like here. In positive characteristic, you may have wild ramification type 1 points, and then different vanish there, and you can describe the slope. And the main property, you have a balancing condition at any type 2 point. And this is the most important, because in order to understand this situation, we would like to understand how it happens that there are points where we have slopes 0, 0, and everything else is 1. We have point 1, 1, 3, and everything else, is, and so on. What is the combinatorics of this picture? The answer is here. It's just a sort of Riemann-Hurwitz formula, or an analog of Riemann-Hurwitz formula. So this is precisely the genus part of Riemann-Hurwitz, and local contributions are also sort of something very similar. And in particular, almost all guys here are zero. So almost all slopes equal to inseparability degree of extension of residue fields minus 1. So almost all local terms vanish. Well, okay, now what about the proof? I'll really give a very brief indication of the proof. So proof of balancing condition. Maybe I have to make one remark. It seems that this formula is a close relative from my discussion with Ahmed. Very probably it's close relative of formula for vanishing cycles of Kato. And probably this formula was described by Renault for covers of curves over DVRs. They seem to be independent. We walk here not over DVR and so on. So formally, probably there are no implications, but it must have relatives of. But again, I do not have any formal claim here. But our proof is very simple. It takes about 2-3 pages. Idea is that delta F is a family of difference, so justify definition of different. So we consider a lattice in omega x, we consider a sort of a lattice of integral differentials, just minimal OX0 model which contains differentials of OX0. And then consider omega y integral over pullback of omega x integral. This is a torsion sheaf of k circle modules whose stocks are almost cyclic and precisely measures the different. And then, then choose some element of k naught of absolute value equal to different, and compare reductions of omega y integral and pullback of omega x integral, but shifted by this number. And these two reductions produce a non-zero meromorphic map between over reduction of between omega c. It should be pullback of omega c y c x to omega c y. And the balancing condition just boils down to computing degrees of this shift via poles and zeros. The degree of this shift is precisely the left-hand side of balancing condition, and local terms will give you. So I just should say here that if extension is inseparable, in general, the natural map from here to here is zero. So there's no interesting map. But if such a picture appears as reduction of map between analytic curves, then we can produce an interesting meromorphic map. And it is responsible for slopes of difference. Okay, now minimal skeletons. We say that a branch at a point of type 2 is trivial with respect to different if the slope is the expected one. If you remember, almost all slopes are equal to some number, and when they do not contribute to local terms, to a balancing condition. So in such case, we say that this direction is trivial from point of type 2. And theorem says that if we are given a skeleton of x, and we want to enlarge it and put inside a skeleton, so we start with, we fix something on x, yeah, to avoid a situation like P1 where we can choose different skeletons, so we just fix some skeleton of x, and then we ask what can be the minimal skeleton of x and y simultaneously, which contains the skeleton of x, given skeleton of x. And the answer is given by a theorem. If we have skeleton and we take its preimage, gamma y, a priori gamma y does not have to be a skeleton, but it turns out that we do get a skeleton of f if and only if ramification locus of f is contained in the vertices of gamma y, and for any point y, all branches out pointing outside of gamma are delta f trivial. So this thing actually produces you, an, at least in theory, an algorithm, how to, given a cover, how to find a stable model of what you have above. For example, here you start with obvious four candidates for bad points, ramification points, so we should include them we should take the convex hull. But we see that there is a strange point on the skeleton where the different behaves not normally. So we must include this direction. When we include all this stuff, the minimal such non-trivial different, then we are done. We get skeleton of both. Okay. And also a different controls the set of if the degree is p, when the different, as I explained here, for example, and on that example, different completely controls the non-splitting locus. But if the degree, for example, is p square or p cube, then it may happen that there is a locus where a huge locus where degree is p and where degree is p square and so on, it cannot be controlled by a single invariant. So the question about all non-splitting locus is still open, different cannot control it in general. And this leads to the last part of my talk. So let's say that a closed subset of a curve is gamma radial with respect to a skeleton gamma if there exists a function on gamma such that S consists of all points whose exponential distance, inverse exponential distance from gamma is bounded by R with maybe it's better to draw a picture to explain it just by a single picture. So let's assume this is some edge inside gamma and there is some function R on gamma from E to R, and the set S is required to contain all points whose distance to gamma is controlled by this function on gamma. So it's sort of something like radial set. Okay, so in all our examples, locus was such a radial set with respect to different. So theorem, there exists a skeleton of F such that its Y part radializes all sets, all multiplicity sets, all together. Moreover, if we found one such skeleton, then any larger skeleton also will do its job. Moreover, in free cases, you can choose any skeleton, whichever you want. These are cases when degree is p, when f is tame, and f is a Galois. Or even you can take a normal curve, which is composition of radial and Galois. Example. Okay, if degree is p, then actually the different completely controls the situation, because we know that outside of skeleton, everything is different trivial, different decreases with constant slope, so we get just different, gives you the radius of the set NFP. Okay, how to prove it? It's really very simple. I call it splitting method. It's used a lot in theory of valued fields. So if you are given a problem about valued field, you often want to solve it as follows. For tame extensions, for degree p extensions, usually you can do it by hands. Then extend to compositions, and you get a Galois extension because any Galois can be split to wild and tame, and wild can be split to degree p. And finally, use some descent to get the non-normal case. And the radialization theorem is proved just by this method, but sort of globalized, a little bit globalized. One uses that a category of Etal covers of a germ of a curve at a point actually is the same as category of Etal covers of spec of h of x, so you can split locally, you can split morphism like extensions of valued fields. Maybe I'll just, since I'm starting to be out of time in a minute, I think, I'll just say the last thing very quickly, without giving details, spelling out details. The last question is, once we have radialization theorem, we would like to know what the radii are. We saw it for degree P, this is different. So is it a natural invariant of extension of completed residue fields? And the answer is as follows. If we just consider this radii, R1, R2, and so on, it's a bad invariant because it's not compatible with compositions. I give you composition of two functions, it's difficult to express radii for composition through radii. So, but you can rearrange it in a clever way. Okay, it will take 2 minutes to explain, so just believe me. You can rearrange it just as a sort of function from 0, 1 to 0, 1 that I call profile function, and it's just equivalent rearranging of this radii. And then the theorem says that if y to x is generically tall, then for any point y of type 2, the profile function, the function which precisely measures all these radii where splitting happens, where we have locus of degree p to the n and then p to the n minus 1 and so on, it's precisely the Herbrand function of extension. So last two comments. Even to formulate this theorem, one has to extend higher ramification theory to non-discrete setting. Actually, it was not existing for non-discrete. You just take proof of Serre from local fields and write something about almost monogeneous extensions. It's doable. And then you can formulate the theorem, and the proof is again straightforward by use of splitting method. You just use the same splitting method, and for simple extensions of degree p, you just compare the two theories because both are controlled by different. And the last is that this radii a priori are defined only at type 2 points, but obviously they form some piecewise monomial family, so there is a result about this. And okay, thank you for your attention.
Well, thank you very much. Questions?
No, just so you mentioned the fact when you consider different, so along the edges it is piecewise linear, but what,
yes.
Is it so? So now what about continuity?
It cannot be continuous in Berkovich topology. In Berkovich topology, for a very simple reason, the locus I describe you metric neighborhood, yeah, it's not closed and not open in Berkovich topology. It's closed in metric topology, but metric topology is much stronger. It's not locally compact. Berkovich topology, your curve is locally compact, yeah? So it's not okay. At Berkovich conference, I would stress this point that...
it is semi-continuous for the Berkovich topology by EASY.
Yeah.
It's always less than or equal to what you think.
Yes. Semi-continuity you have, but that's... That's all, and it's continuous for metric topology. It follows from these radialization theorems.
And it is definitely not continuous in some cases. Okay, like what you said, it's splitting. Okay.
So how does your higher ramification behave in towers?
Herbrand function in this case, again, because you are almost monogeneous, you are sort of rank one. Composition of Herbrand when you have tau, Herbrand function is a composition. But for profile function, which again, it has very clear geometric interpretation profile function, you just consider an arbitrary interval here from gamma to type 1 point, you take its image. This is 0, 1, this is 0, 1. And you have some restriction of f gives you some map. So you have absolute piecewise monomial map. This is the profile function. If you are radial, it's independent of the choice of this interval, yeah. And it's so for this definition, it's obviously compatible with compositions. For Herbrand function, you should prove. But it's in like in classical theory of higher ramification.
No more questions. Well, thanks again.